Welcome, ladies and gentlemen. My name is Camel, but more excitingly, however, welcome back to the Elder Scrolls Detective Series. It's a series in which we investigate, curate, speculate, hypothesize, theorize, and quite often simply highlight and discuss mysteries, curiosities, hidden and generally interesting things that can be found within the Elder Scrolls games. Today, we will be focusing our gaze upon Alduin's Wall and reveal the true depths of the magnificent ancient Akaviri mural. Links to my other Elder Scrolls detective videos can be found down in the description, along with links for my social media. Be sure to follow me on Twitter and Instagram after this video. So, Alduin's Wall. It's something that we are all familiar with, no doubt, but have you ever wondered what exactly is it? What exactly is on it? What's its purpose? I mean, they sure make a big deal out of it during the Elder Scrolls V Skyrim's main questline, as there is both an achievement and a quest named after the damn thing. It also appears 11 times in Skyrim's official trailer, and Bethesda Game Studios even had one built and installed into their office in real life. So clearly it holds some grand importance, yet is so often overlooked and not fully understood. But soon we will understand it entirely, so let's take a closer look through the lens of lore at Alduin's Wall. It is considered to be an ancient wonder of the world and one of the best preserved examples of early Akaviri relief sculpture. It can be found within the ancient structure known as Skyhaven Temple, which was originally used as an outpost for the Akaviri Dragon Guard thousands of years ago. In the first era, year 2812, Emperor Remen II permitted the construction of Alduin's Wall within Skyhaven Temple. Akaviri craftsmen and artisans were called upon from all across the Empire to labor on the monolithic mural for 6 years until it was completed. The purpose of Alduin's Wall was to record all of the dragon lore that the Akaviri Dragon Guard had accumulated over the course of the faction's existence, in hopes to preserve this knowledge against the cantankerous forgetfulness of time and the ages. Once the wall was finished, the entrance to Skyhaven Temple was consecrated in the presence of Emperor Remen II and the temple's Dragon Guard, allowing Skyhaven Temple and Alduin's Wall within it to be locked behind a blood seal that can only be opened using the blood of a dragonborn. Ironically, Alduin's Wall being sealed off in such a way meant that people forgot its location over the millennia, and the lessons carved into it were forgotten also. Alduin's Wall was now rendered a thing of myth and legend over the coming years, and in modern day Tamriel, it's just considered nothing more than a story of old. Until, of course, we, the Dragonborn, open the seal and access Skyhaven Temple with the Blades members Esbern and Delphine, only to find in all its glory Alduin's Wall. Now, while Esbern does explain some of the stunning art on the wall, most of it remains a mystery to the average player, even longtime players, myself included, until, of course, I studied it for this video. Now, the entire left side of Alduin's Wall is comprised of a stunning and frightening scene depicting the Dragon War. During the Mythic Era, when Yzgrimor and his followers migrated to Tamriel from Admora in the north, they brought with them their religion, which worshipped animal totems. The Admorans regarded the dragon as the head of their pantheon, and considering dragons actually existed across Tamriel, this just led to the outright worship of living dragons, Alduin being the chief among them. Now, dragons already believed themselves superior to man and mer, therefore were all too happy with this now perceived divinity. The Dove gave power to select dragon priests to rule over the land in their stead. This led to corruption, as one would expect, and the dragon priests ruled with an iron fist, enslaving the rest of the population. Sure enough, this oppression and misrule led to an uprising and rebellion against the dragons, their priests, and their religion, and thus was born the event known as the Dragon War. At first, the forces of man were vastly overpowered by the dragons and their devastating power of their voice, their thum. Luckily, Parthenax had betrayed his kin, along with a number of his fellow dragons that followed suit. And with a stroke of literal divine intervention, Kyne sent Parthenax to assist man and teach them the way of the voice. In a time of great desperation, man took this new power and used the crippling oppression and heartless tyranny of the dragon's rule and forged it into a verbal weapon. They created their own shout, known as Dragonrend, that forced the affected dragon to land, making it vulnerable, of course, giving the armies of man a fighting chance against their dragon overlords. The war raged on and on, many lives lost, but then came the climax. What would end the Dragon War? This is shown in the centerpiece of Alduin's Wall, no doubt the largest and most stunning depiction on the mural. This portrays Alduin's banishment forwards in time. We see the champions of men, the three ancient Nord heroes, the first and the mightiest of the Tongues. On the left, we have Harkon One-Eye. On the right, we have Gormlaith Golden-Hilt. And at the center, we have Feldir the Old. Together, they faced Alduin at the throat of the world, and with great sacrifice, as Gormlaith Golden-Hilt was slain. In a last effort to save the Kalpa Cycle and the world they knew, Feldir the Old used an Elder Scroll to, unwittingly, throw Alduin from their time into another time. That other time being the Fourth Era, year 201, the time that the Elder Scrolls V Skyrim takes place. This action of throwing Alduin forward in time saved them then, but led to the Dragon Crisis and also created a time wound. But they did what they had to do, and they also didn't really know what they were doing. And if you're interested and you ever get the chance, you can actually find all three of these heroes in Sovereign Guard. Be sure to say hi from me. So the left side of Alduin's Wall and the centerpiece together teach the lessons of the Dragon War and Alduin's banishment. But what of the right side of the mural? Well, this shows events that at the time of Alduin's Wall's making had not yet taken place, but were scryed by an unknown source, said to have been divined by an Elder Scroll or perhaps even ancient Akaviri mystics and wise men. And these are the events that are known as the Prophecy of the Last Dragonborn, when Misrule takes its place at the eight corners of the world, when the Brass Tower walks and time is reshaped, when the thrice-blessed fail and the Red Tower trembles, when the Dragonborn ruler loses his throne and the White Tower falls, when the Snow Tower lies sundered, kingless, bleeding. The World Eater wakes and the wheel turns upon the last Dragonborn. It all sounds well and good, but what does it actually mean? And how does it relate to Alduin's Wall? Well, firstly, although it is small, we can see depicted a staff broken into eight pieces. This takes claim over the first verse of the prophecy, when Misrule takes its place at the eight corners of the world. This is foreshadowing the events of the Elder Scrolls I arena, in which the Imperial Battle Mage Jaegar Tharn imprisoned Emperor Uriel Septim VII within a realm of oblivion. Jaegar Tharn's apprentice, Rhea Silmane, witnesses this treachery and attempts to warn the Elder Council, but is destroyed by Jaegar Tharn before she can do so. Tharn then transforms himself into the image of the Emperor and takes his place upon the Ruby Throne, along with summoning Daedra, which he magically disguises as the Emperor's guard. Now, Jaegar Tharn achieved all of this wizardry by harnessing the power of an ancient artifact known as the Staff of Chaos, which was also the only thing that could undo his plot. Knowing this, he broke the staff into eight pieces and hid them at the eight corners of the world. We, the player character known as the Eternal Champion, collect all eight pieces of the Staff of Chaos, guided by Rhea Silmane's spirit. We rebuild the Staff of Chaos out of the eight pieces only to discover that there is a ninth piece, the jewel that crowns the Staff of Chaos, which is hidden within the Imperial Palace, where we must face off against Jaegar Tharn. Now, once the battle is done and the reformed Staff of Chaos touches the jewel, Jaegar Tharn is undone. He literally melts, and the Emperor, Uriel Septim VII, is brought back from oblivion. The misrule at the eight corners of the world is corrected. Secondly, we can see a great figure on Alduin's Wall. This claims the second line of the prophecy, when the brass tower walks and time is reshaped. This is foreshadowing the events of the Elder Scrolls II Daggerfall, in which the spirit of late King Lysandus of Daggerfall has risen with a vengeful spectral army and haunts the streets of the Breton city. Uriel Septim VII calls upon an agent, the player character, to perform two tasks. Firstly, to put the ghost of late King Lysandus to rest, achieved by unshackling his earthly bonds. And secondly, to intercept a specific letter that has gone missing. Now, the letter in question indicates that the late King Lysandus's mother, Nalfaga, has knowledge of the location of the Mantella. Now, the Mantella is the keystone to reactivating the Numidium. That was an ancient colossal machine god constructed by the Dwemer, known as the Brass Tower. It was once used by Tiber Septim to conquer and unite all of Tamriel under the wings of the Empire. Although this reign of power was put to an end when the Numidium was destroyed by a being known as the Underking, its pieces were hidden and forgotten, never to be used again. But Emperor Uriel Septim VII has had his blades collect and rebuild the Brass Tower, as he wishes to harness the power of the Numidium to mimic Tiber Septim's actions and reclaim all of Tamriel under the banner of the Empire once again. Now, along with the Emperor, however, there are a number of others who seek control of the Mantella and the Numidium. The location of the Mantella is revealed to be in Aetherius, a realm outside of both Mundus and Oblivion. Once it is retrieved, we, the agent, choose who gets the Mantella and therefore decides the fate of the Numidium. Now, there are a number of possible endings in the game, all of which are considered canon, as activating the Numidium resulted in an event known as the Warp in the West, a dragon break, where a timeline forks into differing directions and is then re-merged back into one, so all possible events did take place. The Blades did reunite the provinces of Tamriel under the Empire with the power of the Numidium. Gortwog did overthrow the Empire and the Bay Kings, creating Orsinium once again, a kingdom for orcs, who would now be considered equals with the other races. The King of Daggerfall did defeat the Kings of Sentinel and Wayrest. The King of Sentinel did defeat the Kings of Wayrest and Daggerfall, and the King of Wayrest did defeat the Kings of Daggerfall and Sentinel. All three Bay Kings lost, and all three Bay Kings won. Manamarco did absorb the Mantella and make himself a living god, and the Underking did absorb the Mantella's power and erase the Numidium from existence. All of these conflicting timelines branched out, canonically happened, and then re-merged thanks to the Numidium, and thus the prophecy was fulfilled. The Brass Tower walked, and time was reshaped. Thirdly, we can see a mountain spewing forth foul ash and cinders. This lays claim to the third line of the prophecy, when the thrice blessed fail and the Red Tower trembles. This is foreshadowing the events of the Elder Scrolls III Morrowind, in which the Tribunal, Almalexia, Sothasil, and Vivek, the living gods of the Dunmer, ventured to Red Mountain to replenish their godlike powers from the heart of Lorcan, only to be ambushed by Dagoth Ur, a new, reborn incarnation of the Tribunal's old ally, Vorin Dagoth, who was supposedly betrayed by the Tribunal along with Indoril Nerevar at the Battle of Red Mountain thousands of years ago. So now not only is the Tribunal cut off from their source of power, but Dagoth Ur has harnessed this power from the heart of Lorcan for himself and is now a living god too, with a strength that exceeds the combined efforts of the Tribunal. Dagoth Ur has come as the false dreamer, the Sharmat, and plans to erase the Empire from Morrowind and resurrect the sixth house, his house, the Tribe Unmourned, House Dagoth. Dagoth along with his army of sleepers, dreamers, ash zombies, ash ghouls, ascended sleepers, and ash vampires, has begun to spread a plague across the land known as the Corporus, or as Dagoth refers to it, the Divine Disease, a horrible blight that eats the mind and grotesquely transforms the victim. And in some curious and unexplainable cases, it spiritually ascends the infected. With this new threat, however, the Tribunal siphon all of their energies into maintaining the Ghost Fence, a magical barrier that contains the Corporus to Red Mountain. Soon, Almalexion and Sothasil withdraw, leaving only Vivek to protect Vardenfell against the Corporus, and even this was failing. All the while, Dagoth is building a mechanical titan at the heart of Red Mountain, called the Akulakon, the second Numidium, powered by the heart of Lorkhan, which he wished to use to conquer all of Tamriel and overthrow the Imperial Dogs of the Empire. We, the player character, arrive on Vardenfell, and after completing a long series of trials, we are revealed to be the Nerevarin, the professorial reincarnation of Indoriel Nerevar, an ancient hero of the Dunmer. With the assistance of the poet warrior god Vivek and Kagranak's tools, the Nerevarin faces and defeats Dagoth by destroying the heart of Lorkhan. The Sharmatz is dead and defeated, the blight is ended, Vardenfell is saved, peace is restored, but now the Tribunal have lost their source of divinity. This creates new problems for the Tribunal, as their godhood is lost. After much mayhem, social and political discourse in Morrowind's capital city Mournhold, it is revealed to the Nerevarin that Almalexia has quite literally gone insane and has killed Sothasil, pinning him as the antagonist and the mastermind behind the recent disasters that the people of Mournhold have faced. She did this, Almalexia did all of this to her people, so that she could be Morrowind's savior, literally solving problems that she created to regain the faith of her people. Almalexia is righteously destroyed by the Nerevarin. Soon, Vivek vanishes, and with him, the magics that hold the Ministry of Truth above the city of Vivek. This causes it to fall and crash into Vardenfell, causing Red Mountain to erupt. While not as obvious as something like the Crystal Tower, Red Mountain is considered to be one of the towers of Tamriel, and it is known as the Red Tower. It is now broken and weeping, Vardenfell destroyed, and the living gods Almalexia, Sothasil, and Vivek have fallen. And thus the prophecy is fulfilled, when the thrice blessed fail and the Red Tower trembles. Fourthly, on Alduin's wall, we can see shown a gate to Oblivion with a large tower behind it. This claims the fourth line of the prophecy, when the dragonborn ruler loses his throne and the White Tower falls. This is foreshadowing the events of the Elder Scrolls IV Oblivion. It begins as Emperor Uriel Septim VII attempts to flee the Imperial City after receiving word that his sons have been assassinated. While in the dungeons below the city, he hands us, the player character, the Amulet of Kings and tells us of his illegitimate heir, Martin Septim. Immediately after this, a member of the Order of the Mythic Dawn assassinates the Emperor, just as they did to his sons. The Mythic Dawn being a Daedra-worshipping cult that serves the Prince of Destruction, Mehrunes Dagon. They sought to remove the Septim bloodline from Tamriel, as when the Amulet of Kings is worn by a Septim, the dragon fires remain alight. They are the barriers between Mundus and Oblivion. But with the Emperor dead and no Septim wearing the Amulet of Kings, the dragon fires are extinguished, allowing the forces of Oblivion to breach Mundus and thus begin their invasion known as the Oblivion Crisis. Martin Septim, Uriel Septim VII's illegitimate heir, is located at Kvatch and saved, but in the process the Amulet of Kings was stolen by the Mythic Dawn from Wainon Priory. Martin Septim, being the last hope to close the gates of Oblivion, is escorted to Cloud Ruler Temple. the headquarters of the Blades, where he works in ending the invasion of Mehrunes Dagon. Cities are sieged and cities are saved, and with the combined might of Cyrodiil, the Great Gate of Bruma is closed. We, the now hero of Kvatch, then enter a pocket of oblivion known as Gaia Alata, Mankar Cameron's paradise, where we find Cameron himself, wearing the amulet. He is defeated and the Amulet of Kings is returned to its rightful owner, Emperor Martin Septim. But as the new Emperor returns to the Imperial City, Mehrunes Dagon himself appears in an attempt to stop the dragonfires being relit. The capital city of Tamriel is being crushed by the Daedric Prince of Destruction himself. In an attempt to save his city, his people, and Tamriel, Emperor Martin Septim bids us farewell and breaks the Amulet of Kings. This results in a forced divine intervention as Martin Septim is fused with an avatar of Akatosh, which then battles and defeats Mehrunes Dagon single-handedly. The avatar then roars in vehement victory and turns to stone. The Oblivion Crisis has ended, the day is saved, but the Imperial City, the home to the White Gold Tower, lays in ruins, and the line of Septims, the dragon-blooded lineage, ends. Years later, the Great War begins, and the Second Aldmeri Dominion sacks and captures the Imperial City, forcing a surrender by Titus Mead II, metaphorically allowing the White Gold Tower to fall. And thus the prophecy is fulfilled, when the dragon-born ruler loses his throne and the White Tower falls. Fifthly, on Alduin's Wall, we see a giant mountain cracked and broken. This lays claim to the fifth line of the prophecy, when the Snow Tower lies sundered, kingless, bleeding. This is foreshadowing the events leading up to the Elder Scrolls V Skyrim. Now, much like Red Mountain, known as the Red Tower, the throat of the world is considered as the Snow Tower, one of the towers of Tamriel. In this sense, it is a metaphor for Skyrim and her people. As while the Snow Tower itself isn't sundered, bleeding, or broken, the province is. The Great War has left a division between the true sons and daughters of Skyrim, the Stormcloaks, and the remaining forces of the Imperial Empire within the province. When the White Gold Concordat was signed, Talos worship was outlawed, Talos being a commonly worshipped divine amongst the Nords. Ulfric Stormcloak asked for an audience with High King Torig of Skyrim, and rather than requesting independence from the Empire, Ulfric saw the king as weak and unfit to rule his homeland, Skyrim. Ulfric Stormcloak then challenged High King Torig to a traditional Nordic duel, to which the king accepted. However, Ulfric, being a force of Nordic power, unleashed the Way of the Voice and blew the weak High King's body to pieces with his thumb. This left Skyrim kingless. The Old Holds then joined Ulfric's cause, while the Other Holds joined the Empire's cause. And thus the prophecy was fulfilled. Skyrim is kingless, Skyrim is bleeding, and the Snow Tower lies sundered. Metaphorically, of course. Sixthly and finally, we see a great hero holding back the ferocity of Alduin, with the Blades kneeling in praise. This lays claim to the final line of the prophecy. The World Eater wakes, and the wheel turns upon the last dragonborn. Now, as mentioned earlier, Alduin was thrown forward in time, and this is the point where he landed, for lack of a better term. In this time period of the Elder Scrolls V Skyrim, and the wheel, that being the Wheel of Time, turns upon the last Dragonborn, our player character. It's up to us to defeat the World Eater once again, and thus the entire prophecy of Alduin's Wall is fulfilled. A very full and telling foreshadowing, and I'm sure we're all very curious to see as to what comes after. So I do hope that you have enjoyed the discovery of the true knowledge and prophecy inscribed into Alduin's Wall. But I'm very interested to hear your thoughts on the wall, Alduin and the Dragon Guard and the prophecy. What do you think's coming next? And who came up with the entirely accurate prophecy of the last Dragonborn? Did we truly stop Alduin? Will the Kalpa cycle continue forever? Such questions are all in a day's work when it comes to investigating the Elder Scrolls series and its many strange stories. So I do hope you have learnt something new about the beautifully mad universe that these wonderful games take place in, the Elder Scrolls. If you do have any information, facts, evidence, speculation, theories, or anything to do with what we have investigated, be sure to comment down below. I'd love to hear what you have to say. If you do have any ideas for something that should be covered in an Elder Scrolls Detective series video, be sure to let me know. I'll look into whatever strange and wonderful topics you present. If you enjoyed this video, please do me a kindness and leave a like. It makes the video look good, and it lets me know that you enjoyed the content. Leave a comment with your Elder Scrolls Detective ideas and your thoughts on Alduin's Wall. And of course, if you enjoyed this video and you want to see more videos similar to this one, please subscribe. It helps me know that people enjoy these kind of videos and will result in more of them in the long run. Be sure to click the little bell icon next to the subscribe button right here on YouTube so that you are notified when new Elder Scrolls Detective videos are uploaded. My other Elder Scrolls Detective video links can be found down in the description. Down there are also links for all of my social media. Be sure to follow me on Twitter and Instagram, and if you would like to support the channel in a more personal way, you can become a patron on Patreon or sponsor the channel right here on YouTube via the join button. As I'm sure you know, all of my time and energy goes into making these videos that I create for you to enjoy, so your support is most appreciated and welcomed in any and all forms. So thank you very much for watching, thank you for supporting the channel. I've been Camel, and I'll see you very shortly in the next video. I'll see you there soon.